الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على افضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الامين وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى كما ورد في سورة النساء اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ان الله يأمركم ان تؤدوا الامانات الى اهلها واذا حكمتم بين الناس ان تحكموا بالعدل ان الله نعما يعظكم به ان الله كان سميعا بصيرا يا ايها الذين امنوا اطيعوا الله واطيعوا الرسول واولي الامر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ربنا ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم ارنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وارنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم ارحمنا بالقران العظيم واجعله لنا اماما ونورا وهدى ورحمه اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل واطراف النهار واجعله لنا حجه يا رب العالمين امين Dear brothers and sisters and sons and daughters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As you must be remembering, we completed the translation and brief study of the first 57 ayat of Surah An-Nisa last night. The two ayat which I have just recited are most profound ayat of the Quran regarding the fundamental principles of Islamic State. Just as we read two ayat, ayah number 32 and 34, they were most profound regarding the institution of family. Ayah number 34 says, الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض وبما أنفقوا من أموالهم فالصالحات قانتات حافظات للغيب بما حفظ الله إلى آخر الآية. So in the same way, these two ayat are very basic, very fundamental regarding the structure of Islamic State. And in these two ayat we find that all the three pillars or the basic institutions, they have been mentioned of an Islamic State. Although the terminology used here is not of the modern political science. These are general terms, general words. But if you analyze the ayat, you find that all the three pillars of a state. In a modern state, we have three basic institutions, basic pillars. Legislature on the one side, executive on the other side, and then the judiciary. So you will find that all three of these are being mentioned here. And let me explain in the beginning. The political system of Islam is that of caliphate. The first basic principle is that sovereignty belongs to Allah. Not to any human being as individual, or not to the nation or humanity at large collectively. In al-hukmu illa lillah, sovereignty belongs to him. Now if sovereignty belongs to Allah, what remains for the humans? That is called khilafa, vicegerency. What is it? Whatever commands are coming from the real sovereign, you have to implement as such. You can't alter. You can't change them. Not even 100% of you can make any change in it. What to speak of 51%, majority or minority? Absolutely irrelevant. What command is coming from Allah is to be implemented as such. Where there is no specific instructions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is amrukum. Now Allah has given this sphere to you. Wa amruhum shura bainahum. Here you can have mutual consultation. Decide the matters. But till that time that the institution of Nabuwa, institution of prophethood was continuing, the Khilafah used to be personal and individual. The Nabi was the caliph in his own person. That is why we find in the Quran, Hazrat Dawood alayhi salam was addressed, Ya Dawoodo, inna ja'alna ka khalifatan fil ard. Here the pronoun is singular. O Dawood, we have declared you to be the caliph on earth. Inna ja'alna ka khalifatan fil ard. Because it's very logical. Allah is sovereign, and this person, this human being, he is Nabi, he is prophet. He has a direct communication with the real sovereign. The commands of Allah are coming to him. So he has to implement them. So he is the caliph in his own individual person. That is why singular pronoun used, Ya Dawood, inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil ard. And this continued. Till such time that the institution of Nabuwah, prophethood was continuing, this was the condition. That is why we find in the hadith, the Sahih of Bukhari, rahimahullah, Kanat banu Israel tasusuhumul anbiya, kullama halaka nabiyun, khalafahu nabiyun. The community matters, the political affairs of Bani Israel were in the hands of the prophets. Whenever a prophet died, another prophet was in his place. Just as we know, Hazrat Dawood died, he was the caliph, and he was the prophet, and after him, Hazrat Sulaiman, alayhi salatu wa salam, he is the caliph, and he is the prophet. But now, when this institution of prophethood has come to an end in the person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now things are changed. This caliphate is now collective for the ummah. That is why now we find in Surah An-Nur that the plural pronoun is used. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. It is not ka now, it is not one person. لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. This khilafat is now has become a collective affair of the Muslim ummah as a whole. So these are the basic principles. And then, you know, there are the institutions. There must be somebody who has to look after the affairs of the state. You may call him the head of the state, you may call him anything. You may call him caliph, but there should be an executive machinery to manage the affairs of the state. Then you know, ijtihad is to be continuously made. Legislation, this process will continue. New problems will arise, and we shall have to solve them. So there has to be a legislature also. Then there has to be a judiciary also. So all these three basic principles and basic ingredients of a state, modern state, we can say that they are potentially present and mentioned in these two ayat. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. The first instruction. Verily, O Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordains upon you that you hand over the trusts to those to whom it belongs or to those who are worthy. Now what is the trust? When you are a community, you have to elect or select or somehow. You must have some caliph, some head of the state. You have to elect him by mutual consultation. Amrahum shura bainahum. Now this authority that you have as a vote, for example, I can say, this is the biggest trust of the community and of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your hand. Now if you are giving this vote to a person who is not worthy of it, so you are making khiyana. You are not proving to be ameen. Actually, all these things, whatever offices, whatever responsibilities are to be given to the people, to manage the affairs of the community, of the ummah. So these things should be given, the offices, the responsibilities. These are the trust with you. And you have to hand them over to people who are worthy of it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. Who have the capability of making ijtihad? Who can be entrusted with the process of legislation in the Islamic State? You have to select them or elect them whatsoever it is. And who is going to be the head of the state? You have to elect him or select him. But this opinion that you give, the vote that you give, that is the biggest trust. And you have to use it for the persons who have the capability and who are worthy of it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. Now the second institution, and that is judiciary. وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. And when You are judging between the people. Any dispute, any affair which has erupted, and you sit in judgment, whosoever you are. Whenever you are judging, وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ between the people, among the people, أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ you must judge with justice. No special favors to anybody. You have to cling to the justice principles of adl and qist. إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعِذُكُمْ بِهِ these are very excellent teachings and advices that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Because on this is based the structure of the state. And what is state, by the way? When a society reaches a mature organization stage, it becomes a state. As I told you, what is society? It's a collection of families. Now an organized society becomes a state. And now you have to manage the affairs of that state. And you have to have some legislature. You have to have some judiciary. These are the two essential ingredients of that state. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَى أَهْلِهَا Number one. Number two, وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعِذُكُمْ بِهِ These are the best advices, most excellent teaching that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever listening, ever seeing. Now comes the second ayah, and this is rather more profound. This is discussing the executive head. You may call him caliph, head of the state. Here in United States, you have the president, and so on. Or in the parliamentary system, it's the prime minister, so on. Whosoever is there. Now, what is the sequence of obedience in Islamic state? Who are to be obeyed? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ O you who believe, or O you who profess to believe, who claim to believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger and those who are placed in position of authority from amongst you. Now there are three, Allah, Rasul, and Ulul Amri Minkum. Now see how beautifully differentiation has been made. The verb ati'u has been repeated twice, but not with the third. There could be two other forms. Ati'u could be taken out of the bracket as a common factor. Ati'u Allah wa Rasoola wa Ulul Amri Minkum. Not to repeat again. أَتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ Within the bracket, all the values are multiplied by the value which is outside the bracket. Or it could be repeated all the three times. أَتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَأَتِيُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأَتِيُوا أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has discarded these two modes of expression. And He has taken أَتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَأَتِيُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ What does it mean? The itaah, the obedience to Allah and Messenger is absolute and permanent, unconditional. You have to obey them anyhow. These are the two basic sources of Islamic law, fundamental sources of the Islamic law. Kitab and Sunnah, as we call it, the Book of Allah, that is in place of Allah now. And number two, the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is in place of Rasul. Atiyu Allah wa Atiyu Rasul. And these two are fundamental. And these are permanent. You can't question the authority of Allah, and you can't question the authority of the Messenger. You can't have a dispute or a difference of opinion with Allah. And in the same way, you can't have a dispute or a difference of opinion from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But for the third, this verb atiyu has not been repeated. There's some basic difference. Wa ulil amri minkum. And also, you obey the ulil amr who have been placed in authority. Now, how have they been placed in authority? That is given in the first ayah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَى أَهْلِهَا You select them, you elect them, but you know you should be honest and sincere. You should give these positions of authority to those only who are worthy of it, who are capable to deliver the goods, not to your relatives, not to your tribesmen, not to somebody who can do some personal favor to you. No! This is dishonesty. Insincerity to Allah and the Islamic state. So you have to give this amana to the people, to the persons who are capable of holding it, this position. Now when they are in the position, now you have placed them in authority. You have selected Abu Bakr as Khalifa. He was not appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nor he was nominated by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was by mutual consultations that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they elected him. So actually now this is not Ma'mur bin Allah. Previously the Prophet who was Ma'mur bin Allah, he was the Caliph. You had to accept him anyhow. But now that institution of prophethood has come to an end in the person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After him, no one is Ma'mur bin Allah. No one can claim to be appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone, you know, derives his mandate or authority from the people, from the community, because they have elected him, they have selected him. But now, from them, you can disagree. Number one, they must be Muslims. Ulul amre minkum. What does it mean? Muslims can never accept from their hearts, at least, that they be governed by non-Muslims. Well, if they are compelled, if they have been captured, if they have been conquered, if they have been rendered helpless, it's something else. But a Muslim can never accept from the depth of the heart the authority of a non-Muslim. Ulil amri minkum. He has to be from amongst you. He has to be Muslim. Not only the head of the state has to be a Muslim. The legislators also can be only from Muslims. No non-Muslim can join the legislature of an Islamic state, because the sources of the legislation are the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet. He believes in neither of them. So how can he be associated with the process of legislation and ijtihad? The process of legislation now in the modern Islamic state will be ijtihad. How can a non-Muslim be assigned this responsibility of ijtihad and legislating and deriving and inferring from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he doesn't believe in them? So they have to be minkum. If you take this American system, the congressmen and your senators, they have to be Muslim. If this becomes an Islamic state, may Allah do it. Then you know only Muslims. Head of the state, Muslim. President has to be Muslim. No non-Muslim can be associated. Non-Muslims will remain in an Islamic state a protected minority. They will remain a protected minority. They will not be equal citizens to the Muslims in the Islamic state. This is a very bitter pill to swallow. But we have to see to the reason, to the principles. This is the basic difference between Islamic state and a secular state. In a secular state, religion is just irrelevant to the affairs of the state. It's a private affair only. You can be a Hindu, you can be a Muslim, you can be a Jew, you can be something else, you can be a Buddhist, go to your synagogue, go to your mosque, go to your temple, go to anywhere you like. But regarding the affairs, the collective affairs of the community and the state, there will be no reference whatsoever to any religion, to any revealed law, to any revealed guidance, nothing of the sort. But Islamic state is based on Islam, based on the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So only those who believe in it can be assigned the offices and the positions of authority, and only they can be assigned the responsibility of legislation. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu atti'ullaha wa atti'ur rasul wa ulil amri minkum. But now there can be a difference of opinion. Everybody had the right to differ from Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala. Every Muslim had the right to differ from Umar radiyallahu ta'ala. Because Umar was not the prophet of Allah. He was not infallible. Abu Bakr was not a messenger of Allah. He was not infallible. And you know, there was a difference of opinion regarding the lands which were captured by the Muslims. The big lands, big countries, Syria and Iraq and Iran and Egypt. Now some of the Muslims and the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they demanded that this is Mali Ghanima, this is booty. Now divide it amongst us. You can keep only 1/5 to the state. For the state, 1/5. And the 4/5 have to be distributed among people who were fighting in the field. Hazrat Umar said, no, this is not Mali Ghanima. This is Mali Fay. And this will go totally to the Baitul Mal of the Muslims collective. They will be owned collectively by the Muslim Ummah, not distributed. This would have become the biggest feudal system of human history, you know. A few thousand people, they conquered all these countries. This was the ijtihad of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. But you know, there was a different opinion. Matter was discussed. A special committee was assigned. Five sahaba from Aus, the tribe of Aus, and five from the tribe of Khadraj, they were formed into a committee. And then they consulted. And then they approved that ijtihad of Umar radiallahu ta'ala is correct. And that it was the consensus of the Muslims now. That is why there is a differentiation of lands. This is Ushri, this is Kharaji. If a Muslim owns a land, piece of land, a farm, then it is Ushri. Only 1/10 or 1/20 of the produce will be taken. Ushri. But if it is Kharaji, it is the collective property of the Muslim Ummah. It is not the personal property of any Muslim individual. Now they are tenants. Whosoever are working over there, they are tenants. They are not owners of that field, or that farm, or that piece of land, and they will pay even 50%. All will go straight. Kharaj, it is called kharaj, not kushr. So this is an example I gave you. If there is some difference of opinion between you and the people who are at the helm of affairs, what to do then? Where to go? If I am differing from the opinion of Abu Bakr, what to do now? He says, I have deduced this from Quran and Sunnah. I say, no, I differ from your opinion. I deduce in this way. My inference is this. Now, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. Now, here, a common citizen of the Islamic State and the head of that state, they are at par. The decision will be given by Allah and His Messenger. Because only the obedience to Allah and the Messenger was absolute. What does it mean? Now it has to be decided by the judiciary whether which opinion is more correct, more near the spirit of the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If you really believe in Allah and if you really believe in the last day, ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ وَأَحْسَنُ تَعْوِيلًا. This is the best way to conduct affairs of the community and state. And this is going to produce the best results. In the end, you will find this is the best way. Now, because in the early days of caliphate, this judiciary was not present over there as a different and independent institution. Let me tell you, first of all, during the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was the caliph. He was heading all the, not only three institutions, but all the four institutions of the state. He was the head of the state, he was the caliph. If Hazrat Dawood was caliph, was not Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the caliph of Allah? He was the caliph. Because the commands of Allah were coming to him. Then he was the legislator. That is why we call him Shari' alayhi salam. He had to interpret. He had to interpret the wahi which is coming to him from Allah. And he had to make new fresh judgments. Then he was the chief justice also. All these matters and disputes had to be settled by him. And he was the commander in chief also. All the four, you know, positions were held by whom? By Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But gradually these institutions, they got separated from each other. In the days of Hazrat Ali, we know that judiciary became independent. Because Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala filed a suit in the court of Qadi Shureh. And you know his case was dismissed because he could not produce any witnesses to his claim except the son and the slave. And Qadi Shureh said, no, although we can't say that you are telling a lie, but it's a law. All Muslims are equal in the eyes of law. Here you are. Not as the caliph of the state. Here you are appearing as a Muslim, a citizen. Judiciary is higher up. Whosoever is judging. إِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَنْ تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. Now because the witness, the testimony of a son or a slave who is owned by the person, it is not acceptable. If you have another witnesses, produce them. And Hazrat Ali said, no, I don't have any other witnesses. Okay. Your case dismissed. And it was against a Jew. And the Jew accepted Islam saying this, that this is the condition of the state. The head of the state, his claim can be dismissed in the state. So he became a Muslim. But these institutions now today, by the process of social evolution, and let us do justice to others also, we owe this to the Western nations. They have developed these institutions of the state. We Muslims gave them the light from the universities of Cordova and Granada and Toledo. We passed the torch of knowledge and light to them. And then we went to sleep. These people worked. The scientific development took place there. This electricity was not invented by any Muslim, but we are using it. This loudspeaker, these cameras, not invented by any Muslim, we are using them. In the same way, these institutions, they have developed. In principle, essentially all these things were given by the Muslims. These all things were given by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to humanity at large. As Allama Iqbal says, Har koja bini jahane rangobu, aake az khakash beroye darzu, ya ze noore Mustafa ura bahast, ya hunuz andar talashe Mustafa. Wherever you find something good, something noble, from which the seed of desire, it grows up, you will see, either this light has been borrowed from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or man is still proceeding and trying to reach where Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taken the humanity 1400 years ago. Har koja bini jahane rangobu, aake az khakish broyad arzu, ya ze noore Mustafa ura bahas, ya hunuz andar talashe Mustafa. So this judiciary now there's the Congress, legislation vested with them. Here's the executive. The president is the executive head. The executive machinery is under him. And here's the judiciary. And here's the constitution. If the executive head or the executive machinery is doing something wrong, you go and knock the door of the judiciary, the superior courts. So this is the system that has evolved in the West. And let me say here, at the highest level of evolution today stands the American constitutional system. The British parliamentary system lags much behind. There's duplicity. Head of the state is someone else. Head of the government is someone else. How can the powers be balanced between the two? Head of the state there, the king or the queen, is just nominal, symbolic, nothing to do with the affairs of the state. All the authority is in the hands of the prime minister. But if we imitate, and we are imitating their example, what happens? In Pakistan, either the head of the state is rendered to the position of Chaudhry Fazl-e-Ilahi, and then people have to demand he must be released from the presidential palace. So he is in prison over there. Or the president becomes Ziaul Haq, or who was this fellow? Ishaq Khan. He can dismiss elected prime minister and just send him home. There can be no balance. And this is shirk. The authority at the head, at the top, should be held by one person. The same person, head of the state and head of the government. This is Tawheed. And actually they have gone there. Only if they had, I have been saying it in my long lectures regarding the political system of Islam, if to this constitution of United States you add only three things, it becomes caliphate, Islamic caliphate. You add the objective resolution as we have in Pakistan, but there it is only theoretical, not practical. The sovereignty belongs to Allah. This should be the clause one. Clause two, no legislation can be done here at any level repugnant to the Quran and the Sunnah. Atiullah wa atiur Rasul. Absolute obedience to the two. And number three, full citizenship of the state is held only by the Muslims. The non-Muslims, they are protected minority. Their lives, their honor, their belongings, they will be protected. They will have free hand in their personal law, in marriages, etc., etc., inheritance. They will be free to practice any religion they like. But they will not be associated in the process of legislation, number one, and at the highest level of policy decisions. They are barred from that. If you add these three things, it becomes the most advanced khilafah on earth. But each one pill of this is very bitter to swallow. We have not been able to swallow it up till now in Pakistan. So what to speak of United States of America? But we have to work towards that end. Now, after these two ayat, we proceed further. And as I told you in the beginning yesterday, that a very big chunk of this surah An-Nisa, it deals the affairs of the munafiqoon, without naming them. In the end, they will be named also. But in the beginning, although they are not mentioned, but actually these ayat are discussing the problems that were created or who were being faced by the munafiqeen themselves. But let us first of all know who is a munafiq. Who were the munafiqeen of Medina at that time? There were certain people in Medina who accepted Islam. But they accepted not by thoroughly understanding what they are accepting. What are the implications of accepting Islam? If you are accepting Islam, you have to be totally obedient to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you have accepted Islam, you have to accept the whole divine law. If you have accepted Islam, you will have to sacrifice your lives and belongings and money for the cause of Allah, for jihad in the way of Allah. These are the implications of accepting Islam. People who understood it, though who accepted it at the face value, there was no problem with them. When they have decided, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ, we have already sold ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this life doesn't belong to me. It's a sacred trust of Allah with me. Whenever He demands, I'll just lay down my life. Now all that I possess is not my property. I have sold it to Allah, already sold. إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Now this is, I'm only a custodian. Whenever Allah demands, I'll present it. Now there's no problem for them. But there were people who accepted Islam only because the whole clan or family or the tribe has accepted. So why to remain separate? Go ahead, you also accept Islam, embrace Islam. Or in an only emotional way, something strikes to you, oh, it's good, I must have it. But you are not looking to the implications. What does it mean? What you will have to do after this. But in that, a flooding of emotion, you have accepted it. But now when the implications come, they waver, they tremble, they start, they are oscillating now. Muzabzabina baina zalik, la ilaha ulai, wa la ilaha ulai. Ima mujhe roke hai, to khenche hai mujhe kufr. Kaaba mere piche hai, kalisa mere aage. What should I do? I have become Muslim. Now I am required to go to fight in the way of Allah, risking my life. Oh, it's not an easy job. Every day the Prophet is saying, "Anfiqu fi sabilillah, anfiqu fi sabilillah, anfiqu fi sabilillah." Oh, this wealth is very dear to me. I can't part with it. Now what to do? So there were certain problems for them. And these peoples were oscillating between kufr and iman. We shall find this ayah very beautiful in the later sections of this very surah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا. They were oscillating between iman and kufr. Going two steps toward iman and then four steps this world. So that there are two steps towards kufr. Now they are oscillating between kufr and iman. مُزَبْزَبِينَ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ لَا إِلَهَا أُولَاهِ وَلَا إِلَهَا أُولَاهِ. They were the munafiqs. But still this disease, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also calls it a maraz. فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. This is a disease. This disease was progressing gradually. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the beginning, He is not naming them, not pointingly bringing them to the eyes of the society. But the problems, they are discussed here. Later it will be made clear who are they. بَشَّرِ الْمُنَافِقِينَ بِأَنَّ لَهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا. Now, give these glad tidings to these munafiqeen. These munafiqeen, glad tidings, that for them there is a very painful chastisement that will come in the later sections. Here, now identify please three main problems. The first problem for these munafiqeen was, how come we have to obey Muhammad in every matter? It's not an easy job.
I can't sacrifice my ego. Who's he? He's also a human being. In every matter, I have to obey him. Number two, going to qital. Hard. Not ready. Number three, and this was not for the munafiqeen of Medina. This was for the munafiqeen elsewhere. When hijrah was made compulsory, because now after hijrah, because the Prophet had to take an initiative, a final offensive against kufr, because the center of kufr was Makkah at that time. Now he had to have the offensive initiative. And for that purpose it was necessary that all the Muslims from all tribes, from every hook and corner of Arabia, they should converge at one point, so that the whole force is there available for the advance now. So it was made imperative, compulsory. You have to migrate, you have to immigrate to Medina. Now people who were at Makkah, for some of them it became very hard to leave their homes, families. They had accepted Islam, but they were not ready to part from their families and tribes. And that was also the case of other people from other tribes. They were scattered breadth and length of the Arabian Peninsula. Now to leave their families, to leave their tribes, to leave the land of their ancestors, where their ancestors were being buried, how can I leave? How can I go? So that was the third problem. So these three problems will be discussed now in the coming ayat. Let us hastily finish the first. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ يَزْعَمُونَ أَنَّهُمْ آمَنُوا بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. Have you not considered, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the case of those yazumun, who think, who claim, annahum amanu bima unzila ilayka, that they have come to believe in whatever has been sent down to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma unzila min qablik, and also the book that was sent before. Now they have claimed to be Muslims. When they are claiming that we believe in what has been revealed to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they have become Muslims. But what are they doing? يُرِيدُونَ أَن يَتَحَاكَمُوا إِلَى الطَّاغُوتِ. They want to get the judgments of their disputes not from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but from Taghut. They want to go to the courts of the Jews. As I told you yesterday, Medina was still a mixed society. Three tribes of Jews were there. Then all of Khazraj people had not embraced Islam. There were still people who had not embraced Islam or declared themselves to be Muslims. So then there were the Kahins and the sorcerers. Now a person says, I am a Muslim, but he takes his case, his dispute to be decided by a Jew, or he wants to take the judgment from some Kahin. What does it mean? He is not acting according to his faith. He should come to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for all the disputes to be settled by him. He is the head of the state, I told you, and he is the chief justice. يُرِيدُونَ يَتَحَاكَمُوا إِلَى الطَّاغُوتِ. And what is طَاغُوتِ? Please understand. What is طَاغُوتِ? I explained last night also. طَغَى, to exceed the limits. This in Urdu, دَرْيَا تُغْيَانِي پر ہے. When you know the river is flooding, it is overflowing its banks. Then we call تُغْيَانِي. Now for human beings, the limits are the limitations placed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anybody who is crossing the limits, مَنْ يَتَعَدَّ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ, he becomes a طاغوت. He has crossed his limits. He has crossed the limits of the Sharia. He becomes طاغوت. Only a person or an institution or a society or a state which acts upon يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, this is the only exception. Every other society, every other institution, every other form of state is طاغوت. And they want to go to طاغوت to get their cases and disputes decided. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ يَزْعُمُونَ أَنَّهُمْ آمَنُوا بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ يُرِيدُونَ أَن يَتَحَاكَمُوا إِلَى الطَّاغُوتِ وَقَدْ أُمِرُوا أَن يَكْفُرُوا بِهِ. And they have been ordered that they must deny and refute طاغوت, not to acknowledge them, not to accept them, not to get your decisions, your disputes decided by them. وَيُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَن يُضِلَّهُمْ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. But Satan, this Iblis, he is bent upon taking these people astray. And these people, these munafiqeen, who want their cases to be decided not by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but by someone else, they are the friends of shaitan. They are following shaitan. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ And when it is said to them, تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَإِلَىٰ الرَّسُولُ Now must be some brother, some Muslim, some true mu'min. He must have said, where are you going to get the decision, to get the judgment? You profess to be a Muslim. Why don't you come to the divine law? إِلَىٰ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the law. And we have Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam among us. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَإِلَىٰ الرَّسُولِ رَأَيْتَ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يَصُدُّونَ عَنْكَ صُدُودًا You will see that these munafiqeen, they hold back from you. They refrain from you. They don't want to come to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because there is disease in their hearts. And that disease is the disease of nifaq. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ What will happen if some infliction comes to them? Some affliction, something unpleasant befalls them due to their wrong attitude. بِمَا قَدَّمَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ Due to whatever their hands have earned. ثُمَّ جَاوُوكَ يَحْلِفُونَ بِاللَّهِ Then they will return to you and they will swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala إِنْ أَرَضْنَا إِلَّا إِحْسَانًا وَتَوْفِيقًا If we went there, you know, O Prophet, O Messenger of Allah, our intentions were not wrong. We only wanted reconciliation. We only wanted something which is good and a reconciliation. We were not going there for any bad intentions. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُ اللَّهُ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ They are the people. Allah very well knows what is in their hearts. فَعَرِضْ عَنْهُمْ So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just ignore them. Why? It's not yet time to engage with them. Because you have yet to consolidate your own position at Medina. The authority and the jurisdiction of Islamic State has not been established fully up till now. So just ignore them. Don't try to punish them. Don't bring them to book. Just ignore them. فَعَرِضْ عَنْهُمْ وَعِظْهُمْ But admonish them. Teach them. Give them advice. وَقُلْ لَهُمْ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ قَوْلًا بَلِيغًا And say to them such words which penetrate into their hearts. This can have two meanings. Some advice which penetrates into your heart, call a baligh. And something which very well warns them that their attitude is wrong. Although the words, you know, used by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are very soft, but they can know what it means. Qawlam baligha. Wa ma arsalna min rasulin illa liyuta'a bi'ismillah. This is the principle. And we have never sent any messenger except to be obeyed by the command of Allah. If you have accepted Muhammad as messenger of Allah, you have to obey him anyhow. You can't refuse. He is the messenger of Allah. This is a very beautiful ayah in Surah Maryam. Hazrat Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wasalam, said to his father, Ya abate inni qad jani min al-ilm ma lam yatik fattabini ahdika siratan samiya. Oh my dear father, to me a knowledge has come, which didn't come to you. So you have to follow me. I will lead you to the right path. Now a son saying to the father, but the reason is, wahi has come to me, not to you. Ya abate inni qad jani min al-ilm ma lam yatik fattabi'ni ahdika siratan sabiyya. So whomsoever you accept as messenger of Allah, you have to obey him. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ جَاءُوكَ وَاسْتَغْفَرُوا اللَّهَ And if, when they had committed some sin, had they come to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا اللَّهَ And they would have themselves asked the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاسْتَغْفَرَ لَهُمُ الرَّسُولِ Or the Prophet and the Messenger would have also asked the forgiveness of Allah for them. لَوَجَدُ اللَّهَ تَوَّابًا رَحِيمًا They would have found Allah to be Tawwab and Rahim. He is the acceptor of Tawbah. Always ready to accept Tawbah. Waiting for his servant to make Tawbah and return to him. And if he returns, he also returns with mercy. As I explained last night, Tawbah is both sides. Tawwab, Allah is Tawwab, and the God's man is also Tawwab. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجْرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. Now this is the final verdict. So no, and by your Lord, لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, they will never be accepted as true moments. حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ, unless they make you the judge. فِي مَا شَجْرَ بَيْنَهُمْ, in all the affairs, disputes which arise between them. ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ. And then the decision and verdict that you give, they don't find in their hearts any displeasure. Although they have accepted, but even if there is a displeasure in the hearts, true iman is not there. This is the level of obedience. وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. And then they have to submit with total submission. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم.